Parks and Worship, we're looking at gathering, proclaiming, responding, and sending forth the most practical one we expect to be sending forth. That's what we're looking at today. And there's not a lot to do in the bulletin, but the sending forth, if you look at that, you'll see there in the last hymn, announcements about what we're going to be sent forth to go and do, and then a benediction. Go and do it. Amen. So there's not a lot there. So you might expect that this would be the time to get very practical, to look at things like, when we go forth to help people, how do we help people in a way that empowers and builds up capacity and doesn't form take people or misform them to depend upon assistance? How do we go forth and how do we talk about that most dreaded of all words in church, evangelism? How do we go forth and talk about Jesus without coming off as jerks or feeling intensely awkward? A practical question. How do we go forth from here? How are we sent forth to partner with local governments to fulfill the church's historic role as a patron of the arts? How do we engage with other parts of our community? These are all very important and practical questions, none of which I'm going to answer today. Another Sunday, but not today. Today we grapple with something that might not be obvious, but is far more important about our understanding of how we're sent forth. When we walk out that door, here's the question we need to answer. What rubs off? When you walk out the door, what rubs off? Can we have an agreement that there's some broken, messed up stuff out there? That's not a hard sell, right? When you go out there, does the broken and sin rub off on you? Or does the holy rub off on them? That's the question. I'll look at that today. And we're going to look at that using Scripture. And as always, when we look at Scripture, we need to look at big, vast chunks of Scripture if you want to make a big, vast point. Because if someone says, well, the Bible says, and then quotes one verse, well, they really haven't said much. You got to look at, well, what's the line? What's the heart? Well, what does the Bible say about this? Because the Bible actually has a story to tell about what rubs off. And if you look at the beginning, the answer is different than where it ends up. Sorry. In the beginning of the Old Testament, that as the people are going towards the Promised Land, you get a whole line of begats. Your favorite part of Scripture, right? Begats. Why do we have begats? Part of the reason we have begats is because it tells us who's in and who's out. Right? Who is us and who is them? And in the Old Testament, there's a very intense concern for making sure we keep track of us because we don't want to intermingle with them. Because if we intermingle with them out there, they'll rub off, and that is going to cause a problem. As we read in the beginning of the giving of the law, the teaching, we have the Ten Commandments. At the beginning of that is we hear that the Lord your God is a jealous God. You're my people. Don't go playing with other people. You stay with your own folk. You don't mix with the Canaanites because you're going to go have this land that's been promised to you. And when you mix in with them, things are going to go wrong because they're going to rub off on you. Their sin's going to rub off. You're going to get sucked into it. It's going to go off the rails and it's going to get ugly. And we see that happen multiple times. We see that this is a continuing theme throughout the Old Testament for when the nation of Israel is refounded. So the nation of Israel founded, it has its run, the northern kingdom that splits, the northern kingdom is destroyed by Assyria, the southern kingdom of Judah goes into exile for 70 years under Babylon, and then it comes back. And so when the two tribes come back and they restart the nation of Israel, what do they have? They have another set of begats, because we need to make sure who's in and who's out. The problem that they run into before was they intermixed with all those other people. Their sin had rubbed off. They'd been led astray. The nation had fallen. So if they're going to start it out right, they're going to start with another set of begats. Who begat who? So we can make sure we have a clear sense of who is us, so we know who is them. There's this intense worry about them rubbing off. And in one of the saddest moments in all of Scripture, when they're reforming the nation and they're learning the law again, and they built the temple, they built the wall, there comes this moment when they look at themselves and they decide that everyone who's married a foreign woman while they're 70 years in Babylon, God divorced them. And so there's this en masse divorce that happens. Anyone who's married a Babylonian woman, send her home. That's that. Right? It is one of the saddest moments in Scripture. It is born out of that sense of if we mix with them, their sin is going to rub off. We're going to have a world of hurt. That's what caused the problems before. Now, there are hints and sort of nods in the direction of something different, something better. Abraham is told he'll be the father of many nations. We get the prophets who show up, and they show up throughout multiple of the prophets. They'll show up, and they'll say, this is God's will, this is God's desire, you're going to be a holy people. And by the way, you should hear, Isaiah does it in Isaiah 2, now it will come about in the last days and the time to come that the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains. To say that my mountain is bigger than your mountain, that does sound like God winning. But and then many peoples will say, come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, that he may teach us concerning his ways. This imagery shows up through the prophets that the many peoples will be gathered from the four corners of the earth will be gathered in God's holy mountain. And so though there's a very real sense that we must not mix with them, there is an opening to what might change. We then come to the life of Jesus. And the way that Jesus' birth is marked, some wise men show up, some astrologers, and we get the sense that someone beyond the Jewish people are paying attention. Even if the Jewish people aren't paying attention to anyone outside of themselves, someone out there is paying attention to what's happening in the Jewish nation. So some number, three wise men, it doesn't actually say in Scripture. So some number of wise men, between two and however many want to pack up and go, show up and they acknowledge that Jesus was born. So there are implications here. The Jewish people are being paid attention to. And as we follow Jesus' life, we start to see this similarity. At the beginning of the Gospel of Matthew, which is the Gospel written by Jews for Jews, the Gospel of Matthew, anyone remember how that begins? Was it the very first verses? The gaps. Right, the lineage, it establishes who is Jesus is one of us. Jesus is part of the tribe of Israel, right? And so it starts by saying, who is Jesus? Jesus is one of us. And then the next thing that happens is Jesus has to run to Egypt. And as you start to follow along what happens in Jesus' life, Jesus begins his ministry 40 days in the wilderness, and Jesus begins his ministry by being baptized, going through the waters. It starts to sound like the life of Israel. Because Israel, they go into slavery for 40, they go into slavery and then they come out of Egypt, and then they have to spend 40 years in the wilderness, just like Jesus spends 40 days in the wilderness, and then they go through the River Jordan to enter the Promised Land and begin the time of God's promise there, and Jesus is baptized in the River Jordan. And this sense that Jesus is reliving the story of Israel, it's called recapitulation. The idea that Jesus is taking the life of Israel and he's living it again to take it one step further. And so we know that it makes sense when Jesus gets to Matthew 10, when Jesus has gathered the 12 disciples, he's going to work with 12, just like the 12 tribes. Again, recapitulation, living the life of Israel. Jesus has the 12 disciples and he sends them forth. In Matthew 10, what does he tell them? He says, go to the lost sheep of Israel. Don't go out there. Don't go to them. It might rub off. No, you stay in-house. You stay focused on the lost sheep of Israel. That's not a surprise. That's what the Jewish people are all about. What happens is, we know that the end of the story, at the end of Matthew 28, we hear Jesus say, go forth and make disciples of all the nations, teaching them what I have taught you, baptizing them in my name, right? We know that in Acts 15, there's the first great board meeting of the church, after the first great council, when they decide that you don't have to be Jewish to follow Jesus. We know that Paul then writes a letter to the church at Galatia where he proclaims there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female in Christ that is open to all. We know that Paul, in his great masterpiece of Romans at near the end of his life, writes that God sent Jesus so that Jesus might be salvation for the Jews and then for the Greeks, for the Gentiles. And so we know that at some point between Matthew 10, when Jesus says, Only pay attention to his house. Don't go out amongst them. At some point between Matthew 10 and Matthew 28, when Jesus says, go forth and make disciples of all nations, and he sends the church off out across the world, that something happens in the middle there. There's a transition point. There's a very awkward transition point. It's one of the most awkward transitions in all of the Bible. It's kind of like those teenage years. And what is teenage years known for? Awkwardness, right? This is the teenage awkward moment of the Gospel of Matthew. If you can think of a more awkward story in all of Scripture, I want you to let me know, and I'll preach it sometime. I can't wait. But this is as awkward and weird as it gets, because what happens is Jesus takes the disciples, and they go out there. They go out to Seir and Sidon, which is, that's across the railroad tracks. That's where my people don't go. I mean, what's the other way to get the point across? And that's not, I don't belong here, right? There's a sense, he takes his disciples out there. His disciples are sitting there going, Jesus, what are you doing? You are going to get us killed. You're crazy, dude. And so they go out there, and they're surrounded by all of them. And they're sitting next to him. And like, what are we supposed to do? And one of them shows up and says to Jesus, my kid's sick. My kid's sick. Help me. And what does Jesus do? We heard it, right? Does he say anything back? Nope. Right? Jesus is being rude. What do you make of that, right? Jesus isn't talking to one of them, but that's the Jewish thing to do. He is living the story of the Jewish people up to this point. The Jewish people, you don't talk to them. The sin might rub off. They're not part of the begats. They're not part of the story of the Jewish people. We don't talk to them, Jesus. And Jesus isn't talking to them. But the woman's stubborn. Talk to a mother with a sick kid. She tends to get stubborn. So she says, no, seriously, listen to me. My kid's sick. She does it a bit more respectfully, but you hear the urgency there. And Jesus responds, I don't throw food from the table to the dogs. Got a few kids. Right? He's there with the 12 disciples, the kids, the children of Israel. I don't throw food to the dogs. Now, some people will read this and they'll try to pretty it up. There are a lot of ways to try to read this passage. And one of them tries to pretty it up and says that Jesus doesn't use the word for dog. He uses a diminutive, like the difference between Robert and Bob and Bobby, right? He uses the diminutive. So it's not actually dog. It's more like doggy or puppy. Sorry, it's not that easy. Jesus insults her. I mean, Jesus is using racist terminology here. That's what it comes off. He's referring to her in a racialized fashion. It's just as bad as it sounds. And she takes this challenge on and says, but even dogs get a spot at the table. Even dogs get a spot at the table. Up to this point, Jesus has been doing exactly what the Jewish people do. Right? You don't mix with them because it might mess us up. And here's the point where the recapitulation, where Jesus starts something new. This is the transition point. Jesus looks at her and he says, you have great faith. You have great faith. This is the highest compliment that Jesus pays anyone, ever. Right? He compliments people's faith, but this is the only time he compliments someone and says, you have a great faith. Because she has taken the challenge on, and she has claimed, no, we are all children of God, and we all deserve a spot at this table, and he has brought the disciples along. And they have watched this argument unfold, and now their rabbi, their master, the guy who they're trying to be just like, has said, okay, that's it. Now you have seen great faith, someone who's willing to challenge God and say, all people deserve a spot here. And this is the turning point. From here on out, when Jesus sends out his disciples, he sends them to all people. And when Jesus commissions the church in Matthew 28, he sends them to all the nations. The transition point, the inflection, the turn is right here, and it is awkward as can possibly be, but here's the point where Jesus goes from recapitulating the life of Israel, and he starts turning it and saying, now we're going to live into the promise of the prophets, that we're going to be alike to all the nations and all the people who dwell with to come to God's holy mountain. And so what changes here is instead of going forth and being afraid of the sin that would rub off on us, what changes from here on out is that we become people God, Jesus calls his church together, and Jesus equips the church to go out and not be afraid. You don't need to be afraid of going out there. We don't go out there. You know, some churches build their own sort of complexes. Like, they build their own, like, bowling alleys and like, shopping and coffee shop and all of that. So you can, like, live your life inside the church. And I get this mental image of, like, when you leave a church like that, they're handing out hazmat suits so you can put them on and huddle and crouch to make sure that when you go out there that none of that sin's going to rub off, because, you know, it might happen, and then you'll be contaminated. You are forgiven people! You are empowered by the Holy Spirit. You are given a spirit of boldness. You are to go out there and to be proclaiming good news, to be good news. You have the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And let's say you go out there and something rubs off. You know what's going to happen next Sunday? You're going to show up, and I'm going to say to you, you are forgiven. And you're going to get to go out there and do it again. We don't go out there afraid that sin is going to rub off on us. We go out there confident that we're going to rub off on them. That we have been given such a powerful and amazing gift that we are going to be sent out boldly to share what we have been given and to seek faith. Because out there is faith, and it's great faith, right? Amazing faith. We just have to go out there and listen for it. As I said at the beginning, there are so many practical aspects of being sent forth. We can talk all day long about how to serve people in a way that helps them and empowers them. We can talk about evangelism in a way that helps us understand that you invite people to go and pick them up and bring them and bring them to lunch. We can talk about creating events outside the church. We're going to walk out there one day and we're going to have a shindig and a band and food. And I can see it just on the other side of that window. We're going to have an amazing event right there. We're going to do these things, but none of it matters if you don't have a spirit of boldness. If you go out there worried that sin's going to rub off on you, we're doomed. If you go out there confident that you are followers of Jesus Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, we're going to do great things. It's going to be fun. I can't wait. What rubs off? Can I invite you to go out there in an entirely safe, sanctuary-compliant way, in a way that does not lead to any lawsuits, go rub on someone for Jesus? Can I say that? Yeah. Good.